Good afternoon to everyone. I'm Davide Torielli, a PhD student from IIT in the Humanoids and Human-Centered Mechatronics Lab. Today I will present ROS and Effector, a focus technical project of ROS Industrial. So as the name suggests, the problem addressed is towards robotics and effectors. Nowadays, and effectors and grippers in general are always more complex, and this complexity also from one side helps to accomplish always more difficult tasks, but to the other side increase the difficulty in integrate this end effector in industrial and research scenarios, or for example also where integration in an already existent arm is difficult because each end effector has its own specific hardware, and usually it requires tailored made software modules that a developer need to write from scratch. There exists some software related on this problem, related on end effectors in general, but some of them are more related to generic grasp analysis. For example, GraspIt and SynGrasp are more related to study how to grasp an object, so how to apply the right forces on the right points on the surface of the object. So they are not really related to control real hardware. Instead, there are a lot of frameworks that make easy to work with real hardware. For example, I put here MoveIt and ROS Control. But in this case, they are not really specific for end effectors. This framework, ROS and Effector, aims to provide an hardware agnostic control framework to try to fill the gap between to fill the gap provided by this problem. So we want to develop, we want to provide a framework that is adaptable to a large variety of end effectors, for example the one figured here that we tested in real and simulated scenarios. And we want to provide a framework that is the most plug-and-play possible, so we want to make it easy to control new end effectors. The features of ROS and Effector are the first is an automatic extraction of the end effector capabilities. So from a few configuration file, we will automatically extract what an end effector can do, and we create what we call the primitive grasping action in this phase. The second point is that, as I said before, that we want to make a new end effector easy to be integrated and also ready to be used for the experiment, for a task. So we abstract the hardware low-level details that are typically used necessary to communicate with actuators and sensors. So about the primitive grasping actions, in general, a grasping action without the primitive suffix is a particular end effector pose. So, in practice, is a particular set of actuator positions. Instead, a primitive is a specific grasping action which is atomic, which means that we can't decompose a primitive into smaller grasping actions. A primitive is defined by a name which recalls its function. For example, a pinch is a precise grasp done with two or even more fingertips that is used to take little objects, for example. And then we have a key which indicates the elements that are involved in the primitive, in the action. For example, we can perform a pinch with the thumb and the index fingers, but for other ends, we can also use other fingers. These are some examples in the figures with the shank end, shank SVH end. This is the primitive that is called trig. In this case, the trig is a primitive that close a single finger towards the palm, so it closes completely the finger toward the palm. And we have two examples in which we are performing a trig with the index and with the middle finger. So the name is the same, but the key here is different because we are using two different fingers. This is another example of pinch. On the pinch is the precise grasp done with, in this case, with two fingertips. On the left side, we have the pinch tight, and on the right, we have the pinch loose. The difference between these two primitives is that the pinch loose is in some way less reliable because the fingertips can touch themselves, and so we can't really grasp two little objects. So here we are saying that the pinch tight is more reliable, so it is more useful to grasp the little objects. But we are also saying that the hand can perform some other kind of pinch that are not so good. Another example is the single joint multiple tips. In this case, as the name suggests, we are using a single actuated joint. So here, joint means an actuator, a motor that is moving more than one fingertips. In the first figure, we are moving three fingertips or finger, and in the second case, we are moving five fingers. The second hand is the cubisoft hand, which is an hand which has a single actuator that close all the fingers. Here we see a table with all the primitives of the framework. We can see that we have the trig category, which are trig, tip flex, and fing flex, are more related to move a single finger or part of it, like the first phalange or the last phalange. When we have the pinch, that is the precise grasp, and then the last category is introduced to include all the hand capabilities that are not suitable for the other two categories. For example, when an hand has a single actuator to close all the fingers. ROS and Effector software is divided mainly in two phases: an offline phase where we extract the primitives, and an online phase where the grasping action and the primitives can be commanded from the external to the end. So in the offline phase, we start from an user input that is only with two configuration files that are URDF and SRDF. The URDF is the standard ROS format to describe the kinematic of a robot. The SRDF instead is let's say, an addendum to URDF, which includes some information that are not that can't be inserted in URDF. For example, we can describe the fingers as kinematic chain, as groups. ROS and Effector find the node ROS and Effector find action after the configuration files are provided will extract the primitive grasping action and will emit them in some YAML file for later usage. This is instead is the line phase that we see a bit later. In the acceleration phase we have the parsing of the primitive, the grasping action, and the configuration file, and then we can command the action parsed before. So in the offline phase, as I say, the user need to provide only two configuration files, and from only these two files, the framework will automatically extract the primitive grasping actions. To do this, we use a method based on the collision checking to find the pinches, all the pinches primitive category. And for other primitives, we explore the kinematic tree given by the ORDF. At the end of this phase, we store the YAML file into this, we store the primitive into YAML files. So this phase has to be run only once per end, and so we can reuse the YAML files anytime we want. There are some cases in which the primitives are not enough to describe what we can do with the end. For example, in this case, we want to describe the grasping with the shank end. And so we can add some other grasping action composing the primitives that the framework has automatically extracted. ROS and Effector provide some methods to compose these actions. For example, in this figure, we see that we are composing an action summing more trigs together. Another kind of custom grasping action is the timed one, which is similar, but here the inner grasping action are executed sequentially, so they are divided by some time margins. And we will see an example of this later. So for the online phase, in the initialization phase, the configuration file of the robot, the primitive, and the eventually other custom grasping action are parsed. After this initialization phase, all the action provided for the specific end can be commanded and then executed by the end. So to move the end effector, we simply have to send a grasping action command through ROS topics. In particular, we use ROS actions that are a particular aggregator of ROS topics that permit us to publish on a topic and receive some feedback on other topics. For example, for grasping actions, we receive a feedback about the completion of the action. The command can be sent directly by code, by terminal, so by directly publishing on the topics, but also can be there is a graphical user interface that is integrated into the framework. So this is the graphical user interface for the ARIE2-END. The GUI, the graphical user interface, is different for each end because it is loaded at runtime and it will only show the grasping action that are suitable and that are defined for the end effector loaded. So on the left side, we have all the grasping action defined. And on the right side, we have a brief look at the join state of the robot. The GUI has also a second tab where we can better see all the robot state. Plus, we can also plot what we want into the integrated plot and see a graph while the hand is moving. So to command a primitive grasping action, we have to play with the GUI. So first we have to detect which action we want. For example, in this case, we want a trig, which is the first row in the square. Below the name, we have a loading bar that is the feedback about the completion of the action. Below the bar, we have to select the finger. In this case, we have to select a single finger because the trig is a primitive. We choose a single finger. For example, if we would have a pinch, we have to select two fingers. Below all the checkboxes, we have a slider. This slider permits to scale the final goal pose of the end of the actuator that we are using. For example, in this case, we don't want a complete closure of the finger, but we want to closure it not so much, and so we are sending not a 100% value, but a 75% value. If we don't want to use the graphical user interface provided, we can simply fill a ROS message with all these informations. To the other side, so to communicate with the real or simulated end, we use an hardware abstraction layer that is integrated into ROS end effector. This layer permits to generalize the way the references are sent to the robot, so it makes simpler and safer to command the ends that are really different, and so we have to communicate with different hardware and different using different protocols and so on. When we have a new end effector, we need a developer that has to implement the get and set methods following the interface provided by ROS end effector. We already integrate a dummy HAL to communicate with any robot we want in simulation, in particular with the kinematic visualizer ARVIZ and the gazebo, that is the de facto standard simulator of ROS. And we have also a specific hardware abstraction layer for the area end that we have tested in real case. So these are all the tested ends. The first shown here is the shank end. We immediately see that on the left side, the grasping action for the shank end are a lot because the shank SVH end has a lot of actuator, has 9 actuators. So this permit us to show the capability of the framework in extracting the primitives. Okay. Then another end is this is a robotic fifth finger end. This end has only 2 actuators. In fact, we see that we have much lesser number of grasping action. The 2 actuator, one is to spread the 2 fingers, the other is to close all the fingers. This is another robotic gripper. This is even more simpler because it has only a single actuator to close the 2 pads. And as the last in simulation is the Cubisoft end, which is an humanoid end, again with a single actuator that close all the fingers. And for the real case, we have the ARI2 end, developed here at IIT. Here we are showing a drill action, which is in the last in the which is in the GUI below. The drill action is a timed action, which includes 3 inner actions, inner grasping action. With this action, we want to grasp the drill and then activate. We want to grasp the drill and then activate the trigger of the drill for a while, and then we release the trigger. As we see in the video, the first is to grasp the drill. Then we wait a bit. Then we press the trigger. And then we release it. And this is a single action, a single grasping action. So we have only to command it once. So as a recap, ROS end effector is a ROS-based hardware agnostic control framework that is adaptable to a large variety of end effectors. The framework revolves around this concept of primitive grasping action that describe the capability of the end effectors and that are automatically extracted from a few configuration files that are URDF and SRDF. The grasping actions are extracted, the primitive are extracted, and the other grasping action are created once, then emitted in YAML file, and this permit to run let's say the offline phase only once, and then we can command the action defined anytime we want to command them. And at the end, we have the hardware structure layer that helps to communicate with the robot, especially with the real robot, abstracting the low-level robot details, such as communication protocols, layers, and so on. We are currently working on improving the HAL, integrated into the CrossBot 2 framework, which, as the name suggests, is the successor of CrossBot 1. CrossBot is a cross-robot and cross-framework software architecture, so it provides an additional abstract layer to help to control, move, and receive feedback from real robots. And the other point, we are working on ROS and Effector Grass Planner. With this, we want to compose a primitive grasping action given the end effector, but also the object to grasp. And so we allow the end, the robotic system, to grasp an object in a completely automatic manner. So we don't have to study how to compose the primitive to grasp a particular object. Here, there are some links. The source code is hosted on GitHub and it is open source. We have also documentation for the user that we try to keep updated. And we have also a video presentation on YouTube that more or less tells the things that I told you today. Here are the references for the things used in this presentation. And that's all. Thanks you for your attention.